Well, can we discuss the question of Peter and Saor Éire politically? Now, Peter's account to me of his experiences was that you couldn't influence them. The selection of the group had been made by action, you know, people engaging in a particular action, defined by that action, in fact, and not by politics, and it wasn't very political, but he couldn't make any headway with them. And he eventually, he's the only account of it, was he took to mocking them, teasing them. For example, he'd said to some of the more backward people that he was gay. Yes, indeed. But,
indeed. You've but no anyway, idea how funny that is. Anyone who
yeah, well, some, when Peter's funeral was on, one somebody, some cynic, comment on the number of grieving widows. You know.
Yeah, but, yeah.
I mean, well, Peter well, needed well. Him. That's the point. And God knows whether that played any part of what happened to him.
No, obviously.
But I mean, nothing could be done, and the whole period of the Mandelite group in Ireland. Looking to Saor Éire, it never, ever, ever made any sense. It made no more sense than Saor Éire made.
Well, perhaps I mean, I don't think there was any question of Saor Éire ever actually joining en masse. There were people there. It was possible. Say Maureen Keegan believed it. Perhaps it could have happened. I don't know. She died too, as you know. So there we were, the two. People most nearest to urban guerrillaism, or whatever you like to call it, had departed. We had nothing. I mean, I could still talk to them, but who was I, a sort of proud, non-combatant, sort of, civilian to the core? I couldn't do it.
But Maureen became involved in Saor Éire very... very, very late. She was in the LBO, I remember that. And she joined very... She can't have been in Saor Éire long before she died.
Yeah, but it was at...
There is a film I saw on television. Saor Éire gives a press conference. They're all masked and Maureen spokesperson.
With one exception, and I believe a guy wearing dark glasses, Liam Sutcliffe.
Oh, you know the film, yeah?
I know the film.
It'd be good to locate it, but Maureen, as you remember, had a speech impediment. And she was absolutely recognisable. And she was wearing a mask, I think. And she spoke, but nobody who knew her or would then afterwards encounter her would fail to identify her from the voice. It was very, very strange. But Maureen, again, I knew her vaguely, but I mean, I don't know how politically developed she was.
Yes, well, perhaps wasn't politically developed, but she was open. That was she could have developed more. We were more or less sort of open. It was by standards. Whether we had a higher standard than say the SB today, I don't know. But say quite possibly. Quite possibly we did, or the Lambertists, as you say. I'm not acquainted with the thoughts of the Lambertists. I believe that, but there is, of course, there was Brouet, wasn't there, in the Lambertists?
He broke with them very, very soon.
Oh, yeah.
He was a member in the early 60s. I remember him at an SLL conference.
Well, in that case, there's nobody else there, you probably were pretty stupid.
But they were an unprincipled sect in the beginning.
Yeah.
And they shared responsibility for all the Healyites, the Paddy J. Healyites abominations. Like, for example, do you remember, you were around in 1967, they went Maoist for the Cultural Revolution. Do you remember that?
I don't remember. Well, I don't remember the I think they did indeed.
And the Lambertists went with them. And the Lambertists were.
Well, they were all buddies in the IC together, weren't they?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean,
from 1953.
Yeah. 1963 to 1972. Paddy was leaning towards the. Gerry, but unfortunately Gerry had his own acolytes, and to be fair to Paddy, I think Paddy would have been too independent for him, quite frankly. Gerry really did not want sort of a genuine independent Irish section.
And Paddy had a notion of self-preservation. He knew very well what would happen if he joined the Gerry-Healyites.
But then, of course, the split came, and Paddy saw the opportunity to join the Lambertists.
Yes.
I don't know. Did you ever see the documents of our row in the YS when we started?
I saw some of them.
Yeah, well, we did reproduce the two initial documents of the Lambert-Healy feud, you may remember. I don't know if you saw
the split in 1971.
Yeah, we did reproduce them they were all in the in the workers' press or whatever, but people were not reading it, so we reproduced them, and we pointed out that basically they had two sections of they'd taken half of the dialectical materialism, and Healy was dialectical idealist, and Lambert was mechanical materialist,
political patter. It didn't motivate him at all.
Yeah, well, we thought
a bureaucratic split. God knows why.
Well, probably was, but that's what they were presenting, and that was the illusion. For example, Coulter, who was the intellectual boss.
Coulter was the initial contact with the Lambertists.
Yeah, yeah.
72.
Yeah, she would have been, and I think she was on what was left of the IC or whatever it was later, most of the time.
She was on the left, did you say?
What?
Did you say she was on the left?
On the IC, on the executive of the IC.
Oh, yeah, yeah, well, that would be...
Yeah, yeah.
But, one of the things that might be worth trying... The history is very much buried and hearsay and so on. One thing I think would be worth discussing is the development of the Paddy-Healyites towards the Gerry-Healyites, which was an extraordinary thing. They, again, I remember it in detail because I was involved arguing with them. The Gerry-Healyites started in a daily paper or a five times a week paper in September 1969, and Paddy wrote them a letter congratulating them, which was very strange. And the Healyites then went through all the zigzags on Ireland that I've recounted in the article I mentioned, and. Nevertheless, the Paddy Healy element of the LWR moved closer and closer to the Gerry-Healyites. There was a debate with the BCO in Limerick, which I didn't attend, but Liam Dalton attended.
Mm. And I heard about that.
Brendan Clifford sneered, "What have Trotsky's ever built?" Mm. And Paddy Healy responded by citing the Daily Paper in Britain, which is a very strange argument. And then they found developing inside the LWR a group of people who took the logic of Paddy and Carroll and Basil, the Troika, who took their logic to its natural conclusion and wanted to join the SLL. And I can date all this because it fits into my own memory. I got to Dublin sometime about the middle of July 1970? Yes. Yeah. I'd been to the north and done to Dublin.
I think you were there actually. I remember you were there in 69. I think was it you and Jeff Hodgson walking? Right. I mean, we remember having a row with you and Jeff Hodgson in Merrion Row. I thought it was 69.
Jeff wasn't in London.
Well, in Merrion Row in Dublin. Yeah.
What was the row about?
Oh, what was to be done? This was after the invasion of the ghettos. I mean, I was confused. Perhaps you were. Anyway, you hit it better than I did. But
what confused?
What is to be? Literally, what is to be done? I think the row over the British troops had just started.
Are you thinking about Operation Motorman?
No, 69. This was both Operation Motorman wasn't until
72.
It happened later. But no, this is the arrival of the British troops to defend the ghettos. That I don't know. Was it the? We weren't arguing about that. But what do you know? because I myself was, well, must admit that I was extremely confused. You know, this was not the way that imperialist forces were supposed to behave. You know, they were getting their cups of tea at that time from Falls Road. And, you know, it was, so I was bewildered, you know, and I think what were you saying? You were saying repartition even then.
I never said repartition.
Well, you were defending it because LWR was,
I, Paddy made it far more formal, that's true.
Yeah, but you were defending Paddy anyway. You were still sort of in cahoots to a certain extent with Paddy, even though if he was sending secret letters to
I remember
Gerry
no
Healy.
Discussion involving Jeff Hudson.
Well, probably it wasn't Jeff Hudson. I thought it was Jeff Hudson.
I remember we came to Manchester. You came to see the enemy in Dudley, Rachel and myself. That would be beginning of 68.
Yes, it was 68, the beginning of 68, but that was it. That was when I was in Manchester, staying with friends. And I came over from Manchester to Leicester Road, Leicester spelt without an I.
Yeah.
And we had a long argument, and got nowhere. And
I was not involved in any such discussion. Again, the question of repartition. We didn't say repartition.
Well, it was sort of quick. It was sort of quick. Scuffle, verbal scuffle more than anything, but I forget you were with a guy who I have it at the back of my mind was Jeff Hudson, but if it wasn't, it was some other, one of your other allies at the time.
Comrades. Member,
what?
Comrades.
Comrades, sorry, I apologise.
This is a stupid thing to say,
yeah?
The facts are as follows. My understanding, and I think it was very common, was that six counties was created as six counties in the territory with lots of Catholics because the Protestant areas would not be viable. Now, that was utter nonsense. It was very common nonsense.
It's very common nonsense, which is about the one thing I can be proud of I didn't share. I thought it was nonsense.
But what we raised, what I raised, NIS, was that the Republicans should talk about the secession of the Catholic areas on the border, mm-hmm. and believing that would make the whole thing unviable, mm-hmm. and would be a wedge against the Orangists, and would force the Orangists into some variant of a united. And now I argued for the right of view of Protestant autonomy within the United Ireland from 69, in fact.
Yeah, well, I don't remember. This is a verbal discussion which we never put into print either of us.
Yeah.
So I don't. I must say honestly, I don't remember those.
There were polemics in IS, suppose.
Yeah, well, possibly. I didn't get. You know, although I was accounted to be IS's man in Ireland, they never sent me any papers.
Well, they were largely no. I was prompted. You thought we had it on sale last night. We had verbal discussions, mainly in the IS and
C. They still haven't forgiven me for deserting.
Yeah. Well, but the point I'm making is I never saw secession as repartition. Mm-hmm. I saw secession as making partition unviable. Now, within mm-hmm. the United Ireland, I could see no argument against giving the Orange areas a very great degree of autonomy. I can't see any Marxist or even Wolf-Tonist opposition to that. They are distinct people, however you define them. And in reality, looking back on this, the argument that home rule will be Rome rule by 1969 was very much the reality. But you couldn't force them into a united Ireland against their will. You could maybe get relations with them where they would be autonomous within a broader framework. Now, I argued for that from 69, but certainly I never advocated repartition. The opposite, I advocated blowing up the Northern, or destroying the Northern states.
Well, that's fair, okay.
On the basis of misunderstanding, you know, but a lot of people had that in 1969, that there was no viable, you know.
It was trotted out by people who should know even better than you. I mean, you know, that it was unviable. Miller was going on, you waving his good economics degree around.
Who?
Miller, Basil.
Oh, Bastel.
Yeah, I used to play it, and you know, it was, I think it was my comrade Brendan Kelly says, but that's ridiculous, they're being subsidised by Britain anyway, so how, you know, what, where's viability? They've been doing it for years, you know. So,
IS raised a call for withdrawing the subsidies.
Criminal.
The exhibit from the Connolly Association is an early appeal. Well, it was criminally stupid, and one of our great faults, mine, was we didn't criticise it enough.
Perhaps you should, yeah.
They just nodded it through and focused on things like troops and self-determination. Mm-hmm. Well, I repeat, secession did not mean repossession.
No, well, that is...
That's in my head.
In the head that was, it was being blown around Dublin, it did, I can tell you. You're blown around a certain sections of Dublin because...
Well, I never advocated it.
Well, okay, you accept that...
Paddy had a very wooden notion of advising the bourgeoisie about...
His approach probably helped him to join the Lambertists, let's face it. Paddy's approach probably helped him to join...
As a Lambertist, he became a nationalist. He became
his approach to two questions, the absolutist approach nuances, what are they, so to speak. He had essentially a propagandistic approach an agitational approach without developing the propaganda to back it.
I think that's true, but